Thank you for participating in this project. Mercury is all around us. Your contribution will help all of us better understand how mercury moves through the environment and understand the risk of mercury to national park ecosystems. To collect samples that don't get contaminated means following protocols and keeping everything ultra clean. To have a fun and safe field event that produces high quality data requires preparation. Remember, to misquote the U.S. Marines, proper planning and preparation prevents poor performance. This video supports the sampling guide for the collection of dragonfly larvae, water, and sediment samples from national parks for mercury analysis. You can download a copy of the guide at the website on the screen. Read the guide to make sure you have enough time for your participants to collect everything, sediment, water, and dragonflies. You will be collecting water, sediment, and dragonfly larvae samples and submitting the samples for mercury analysis unless otherwise noted by the project coordinator. There are a few things to keep in mind as you prepare for sampling. Selecting field sites, identifying and preparing your citizen scientists, communications, paperwork, and record keeping, scheduling and equipment. To keep these different aspects of sampling preparation in mind, this video is split into a timeline of things to do 3 to 6 months before sampling, 2 weeks to 2 months before sampling, and then 2 weeks to the day of sampling. Field sampling is exciting and varied. This video covers the basics, but you will have to add to it for your specific park, sampling site, and citizen scientists. 3 to 6 months before sampling. You may not know when exactly you will be sampling, but you probably have a good idea. Spring, summer, or fall. 3 to 6 months before your sampling window, you can prepare by doing the following. First, identify your citizen scientists. Will you be working with school groups or one school group, or a small group of longtime volunteers in the summer? Perhaps Student Conservation Association interns, or a group from a local summer camp. Perhaps you are not sure and need to talk to the volunteer coordinator. You may want this to be a public program, in which case you will need to work with a communications office to get the information into publications and the press. Knowing, generally, who you will be working with should tell you something about when you will be sampling. For instance, school groups will not generally be available during the summer. Second, select a field site or sites. Dragonfly larvae live in diverse habitats, but are most likely to be found along vegetated bank margins, near snags and logs, in aquatic vegetation beds, and in decaying organic matter, and in silt, sand, gravel, substrate. In your park, are there sites that meet any of these criteria? Ask colleagues in resource management and interpretation. Resource management may have data or other information about certain water bodies in the park, and your work may add to the picture. Conversely, they may want information about a water body in the park for which they have little information. If there are dragonfly larvae there, you may be helping to start a picture of that water body. Folks in the interpretation and education group may have sites where they have successfully run ranger-led programs or macroinvertebrate surveys. They may be able to share with you good, safe sites for sampling. Visit some of the sites. When selecting sites, it's important to find dragonflies for the research, but it is also important to keep people safe and collect samples in the time you have allowed for the volunteer group you are working with. If access requires leaving a trail, is there a safe way to get to the water? Is the ground uneven or over loose rock? Does the bottom of the water body drop off steeply? Are there any poisonous plants? And are there any places nearby where a volunteer might answer the call of nature? Although you will practice leave no trace sampling, this should still be a consideration. Will you be able to see every one of your citizen scientists? Will you have to flag off or otherwise point out a no-go area? Will you be near a road? Will you need traffic cones? Third, planning for your citizen scientists and your field sites, also think about the duration of your sampling event. Sample collection itself does not take very long, but getting to and from sites may. If you are sampling as part of a backpacking expedition, perhaps you can get to distant sites. If you have stalwart summer volunteers, you may be able to access water bodies that are a fair hike from a road. If you are sampling as part of a school group, you may have an hour for the whole event. Combine your thoughts about your site and your ideal citizen scientists. Think about how long will it take to get there? How much of it is driving versus walking? How is the terrain? And once at the site, it is important to remember that you will need a space to set up a sampling home base for spreading out gear. Does your site have that? Sampling event duration and citizen scientists will help you narrow down your sampling site options if you have more than one to begin with. Although we have said that selecting citizen scientists, a site and sampling event duration is a 1-2-3 process, you may want to think about all three things collectively. Once you have your where and when generally established, you will need to apply for a research permit via the National Park Service Research Permit and Reporting System on IRMA, the National Park Service's Integrated Resource Management Application Portal. Before you apply for a permit, it will help to have the following information at hand. Project title, purpose of study, your study start and end dates. This is for when you will be in the field, it is not for the whole project. Identification of any federal funding agencies. Location of your sampling activities, landmarks, place names, and GPS coordinates all help. Method of access, or how you will get to your field sites. Names of your co-applicants, anyone else who you know will be part of the collecting events. And since you are collecting samples, you will need to provide the contact information for where you will be submitting the samples. Some of this information is in the guide, and some you can get from your field coordinator. The permitting process can take some time. Do not wait until the last minute to request a permit. Remember that you will also need to submit an Investigator's Annual Report, or IAR, once your fieldwork is completed. You submit the report through IRMA. For the IAR, you will need the following information. Your findings, the status of your project, the specimens collected, and a confirmation of the research dates. Keep good records so that the IAR is a cinch to write and submit. If you have a group of volunteers in mind, this is a good time to reach out to them. And whether you do or not, this may also be a good time to reach out to a volunteer coordinator who will know all of the ins and outs of working with volunteers and the associated paperwork, regulations, and benefits. If you do not have a group, resource management or interpretation may have some suggestions. 2 weeks to 2 months before sampling. By now, you have your research permit and your field gear from the lab. Check to make sure that you have a complete field collection kit from the lab, read the sampling guide, and watch the sampling videos. Keep your gear from the lab stored in a safe, clean area until you are ready to sample. You will need to provide some additional gear. For water sampling, you will need bagged ice, a trash bag, waders or boots, and your citizen scientists who are going into the water must have personal flotation devices, or PFDs. For sediment sampling, you will need bagged ice, trash bags, waders or boots, and your citizen scientists who are going into the water must have PFDs. For dragonfly larvae sampling, you will need nets, D-nets or dip nets, clean new white dish pans, buckets, or ice cube trays, bagged ice, disinfectant materials, for example, bucket with disinfectant, scrub brush, and tub, field guide to dragonflies or macroinvertebrates, a trash bag, waders or rubber boots, and your citizen scientists who are going into the water must have PFDs. You may also find it helpful to have additional field guides, magnifying glasses or loops, cameras and extra memory card, bug spray, sunscreen, small snacks, extra drinking water, a first aid kit, and reflective or high visibility vests for your volunteers. A side note about bug spray and sunscreen. You and your volunteers will be putting your hands and arms in and out of water. Be considerate of the organisms living in the water and do not put bug spray or sunscreen on your lower arms. Although you may not be able to pull all of this equipment together much before you go in the field, like bagged ice, you should create a checklist of all the materials you are taking into the field. Don't forget to put a copy of the research permit on that list. You will need a copy with you in the field. Pull together what you can. Prep and print written field materials. How many copies of the field ID guides will you need? Should you laminate them? Write a script or make some bullet points of what you want to say to your citizen scientists. Don't forget to include a thank you for their time and help. Draft a timetable for the fieldwork. Include things like driving time, walking time, explaining the project and the field sampling methods, sampling, decontamination time. Set your sampling dates and rain dates. Keep in mind that your sampling date and rain date need to allow for the following sampling requirements. Your samples need to be shipped to the lab for analysis, and there are different requirements for the different types of samples. Water samples need to be shipped overnight within 24 hours of collection. There is no one in the lab to receive samples on the weekends. Thus, the water samples must not be shipped on Friday, and it's best if the water sample is not shipped on Thursday either. The best days to ship are Tuesday or Wednesday, which means the water sample must be collected on Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, with shipment happening no later than Wednesday. Dragonfly larvae and sediment must be shipped overnight, but they need to be shipped frozen. So you can collect these samples anytime, but shipping them should happen on a Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. If you are working with a specific group of volunteers, you can send them background materials and paperwork. Check the website for some of the background materials. Send a photo release, especially if you are working with a school group. Send a gear list to your volunteers, especially if they are to provide their own PFDs in boots or waders. Depending on when you are sampling, you may want to include things like lunch, a change of clothes, camera, hat. Risk assessment. Having a successful field event includes understanding the risks involved with taking a group into the field. It is likely that you have already done a risk assessment, including an emergency response plan, for other programs and projects. Make sure you have one for this sampling event and that you have the necessary field equipment. 2 weeks to the day of sampling. It's time to pull together all of those last-minute details. If you are working with some people who have not signed photo releases, make sure you have a way of identifying these people in the field so that you do not get photos of them. Record keeping. Make sure you have a way to document your citizen scientists' hours. Communicate with your office. Let them know where you are going and when you will be back. Also communicate this to the group you are working with. Include a map of where you will be and the route you are taking to get there. Leave a dated copy of your field itinerary on your office door or desk. Communicate with your project field coordinator about scheduling sampling and any sampling questions you have. Confirm the sampling date, especially if it looks like you will be using your rain date. Check in with your citizen scientists through email, social media, or phone calls. If necessary, include last-minute reminders, maps of the sampling locations, and directions to get there, and a reminder about what they need to bring. Pack all of those items you could not pack beforehand, like the ice or shared equipment being used by many different people. And pre-fill out any of the sections of the paperwork that will accompany the samples to the lab. Find your local source for dry ice. We Googled dry ice and found a store near us. Shipping samples usually takes between 5 to 10 pounds of dry ice. If you have a small cooler, if it's not extremely hot outside, and if you are mailing later in the day, 5 pounds is fine. If you are in the middle of a heat wave or you have to drop the cooler off at 9 a.m., or for some reason you have a large cooler, 10 pounds of dry ice would be better. Sampling itself can be a relatively short part of your expedition. That's all right. Make the whole thing fun. Remember that being prepared is important, but it is only part of your strategy. Having good humor and being flexible should also be part of your plan. Keep things clean, be safe, thank you, and have fun!